My name is David Hostert. I lead the economics and the modeling department at Bloomberg NEF. What I do in my day-to-day job is really look at the technologies, the drivers that form the long term for the energy transition. So we talk a lot about 2050, but today I wanted to talk a bit more about the near future, about 2030, some of the kind of what are the drivers that will get us kind of on road, on track for net zero, and where are we on some of those drivers. So really what I wanted to leave you with is the fact that strong momentum is in fact building. $620 billion, that's the amount of investment that went into renewables just this past decade. So we hit a new record with $1.8 trillion deployed, and this chart focuses on the kind of deployment of technologies that drive mitigation, that drive reductions in emissions. $1.8 trillion, that's a 17% increase over last year. And the biggest driver here is renewable transport, road transport. Investment in clean transport rose to $630 billion. It is now the biggest category, up 36%. Renewables as well, also up 8%. Hydrogen investment tripled. CCS investment doubled. Batteries are up 76%. And this is almost double what we saw in 2020. This data doesn't go back all the way to 2020, but from 2020, it's comparable. We doubled investment since. So a very kind of strong momentum. But as I said, my eye here is really on the far future. So what my teams do is we look at historic emissions on the right in the energy sector, where they're coming from. And then this line here shows you where we need to get to in terms of emissions. The line on the top here is our no transition scenario. So this is a kind of reference case. What happens if we do absolutely nothing? If you think about this as the road to hell, then the technologies in between will show you what are the solutions that bring about this change. Half of the emissions reductions, we think, is going to come from clean power. So clean power includes renewables, solar, nuclear. The solutions that make sure that we decarbonize the existing energy system and we grow the future energy system, because we need to triple that system too. Another about 25% comes from electrification, and this is electrification of end users. It's road transport, it's partly aviation, it's going to be industry, it's going to be buildings. So these are things that we know fairly well how to do, but then it gets difficult from there. We believe about 5% will come from hydrogen in various forms, both in direct use, but also as an input. There's about 6% from bioenergy, which includes sustainable aviation fuels. Half of that is about sustainable aviation fuels, and I'm going to talk a bit more about that. And then finally, about 10% CCS. So these are the things we don't know how to do well just yet. If I look at about the next kind of decade, just the next kind of 8 years until 2030, actually it's a little bit more weighted towards the things that we know how to do well. Renewables are the biggest driver of emissions abatement up to 2030, about 62%, followed by electrification and others. So COP28 was remarkable in the way that it delivered one of the things that we think are necessary to get us on track, and that was the tripling renewables goal. Today, we have about 3.6 terawatt of renewables installed in 2022. In the past, that it goes up to about 10 terawatt in our net zero scenario. So that's roughly about a tripling. So this is the right goal. However, we need to not triple solar and wind, we need to quadruple it, because there's not going to be much growth in hydro. So we need wind and solar actually already need to do more than the tripling suggests. We believe it's the right goal, and we also believe it is achievable. If we compare our short-term forecasts, and this is the things we actually believe should happen, will happen, and then we look at all renewables, actually we are not quite there, but pretty much on track to triple renewables. And then that's good. But if we drill down a little bit deeper into the numbers, we see there is a two-speed race between solar and wind. In solar, we are ahead of our target. Already we're ahead. But in wind, we're not. So our forecast, and to the interview that you saw before the break, our forecast is to about 2 terawatts by 2030, half of what we need in our scenario. And the reasons behind this are partly kind of current reason. It's about cost inflation, it's about supply chain disruption, but there are also long-standing reasons. Access to land, permitting, delays in kind of getting the cost down to the same solar as, level as solar, but we can't slack off wind because wind is going to be a key pillar of this transition. We can't just kind of double up the solar target and hope that this will do it, because wind and solar are very complementary. Our modeling shows this. We need both. They're very important in higher latitudes, such as the UK, and offshore wind in particular delivers very strong advantages when it comes to capacity factors, when it comes to space. So wind has to be a key plank of the energy transition. We talked about renewables. If we think about electrification, particularly I wanted to talk about road transport. Despite of what you may have heard in the last year, EV sales have not slowed down. So last year, we had 14 million vehicles sold on the road. This year, we believe it's going to be 17 million. And that includes electric vehicles and plug-in hybrids. So while there might have been a slowdown for certain companies, overall, we have not seen a slowdown. EVs also now make up 20% of global sales in the last quarter of 2024. So that's 20%. But look at China here. This is 35% in the final quarter. And in fact, we think that this year China will sell more EVs than the EU and the US together. So very strong growth still coming. There's more good news in batteries. If you look at the cost, the input cost of batteries and the surge in 2021-22, we are now back below those five-year surges. And this is one of the most remarkable technology stories, really, of the past decade, that battery prices have come down 90% over the past decade. It's a remarkable story. And after this kind of short, brief bump, we're now seeing the cost come down again. But it's not just about lithium iron. There are also other chemistries now in the mix. Because what happens when prices go up, the market kicks in, right? So we've seen supply went up again. We've seen demand substitution. And we've seen the emergence of new chemistries. Sodium ion, you can see on the right here, there's now weekly announcements from major players about what they're going to do about sodium ion. These batteries have a lower power density. But they also don't rely on the same materials as lithium-ion, and they're cheaper to build. So the first commercial car was launched. This is the JAIC Huashanzi, 13 December last year, first production. We're now seeing new advancements, and this is a very exciting space to watch. We talked about renewables. We talked about electrification. Let's look a bit into biofuels, and I have a soft spot for biofuels. I started my career in energy transition about 15 years ago in biofuels. So this is a topic dear to me. The first thing to recognize is that demand for aviation, demand for travel is still rising. There's a very strong link between how rich a country gets and how much it travels. And you can see that demand, as kind of economies get richer, passenger kilometers traveled go up. We're also seeing more commitment from airlines to decarbonize their operations. So this year counts kind of announcement and commitments. These commitments vary between direct investment to memorandum of understandings, but there is a clear trend of commitment in industry, and it's led by the European and the US airlines. Now, commitment also means that we're now seeing more interesting movements in electric aviation. We're seeing more interesting movement in hydrogen applications. But the biggest commitment really comes from sustainable aviation fuels. So as of December last year, we had 37 billion liters of procurement announced predominantly by US and American companies. And the trick here is this commitment is great, but the real issue is going to be the feedstock. So feedstock, if you think about the predominant feedstock that we need for kind of HEFA-based aviation fuels, is going to be from waste fats, oil, and greases. This is probably enough to do about 3 to 4% of global jet fuel demand today. And the problem really is, for every scenario that we come up with, we're really racing through that feedstock before the end of the decade. So the hunt is really on for what can be the next sustainable aviation feedstock that can deliver us those, can deliver the supply for the demand that is there. I wanted to briefly talk about CCS and hydrogen as well. So CCS and hydrogen play a role in our scenarios, maybe a bit further down the line. But importantly, we need to make those investments now, because if we don't do them now, we won't be ready by the time that they're needed. On the left side, we have low-carbon hydrogen, and this tracks our numbers on what we think will become available and by when. So the announcements at the moment actually outstrip what we think is going to be there in terms of new demand. What that means is we're going to an era where we're going to substitute existing hydrogen. About 47 million tons by 2030, that's about half of current hydrogen demand globally. But we are short when it comes to the uptake that we're expecting after 2030. In CCS, there's also been kind of more announcement, more optimism in the industry. However, we're still very short of the kind of levels of CCS we would need to see in our scenario, and that's something we're watching quite closely. But the kind of the level of activity has definitely picked up. I told you earlier today, hydrogen investment has tripled, CCS investment has doubled last year. So strong momentum is building. But we are now halfway through a critical decade when it comes to climate change. If I think about our own scenarios, whatever scenarios we can come up with, at the moment we are emitting at peak every year, so there's going to be a drop-off. And the more we delay, the steeper the drop-off. So strong momentum is building, but time is of the essence. The planet is not only getting hotter, it also suffers from a serious bout of election fever. We watching elections in all these different regions, and we did an analysis, and like obviously where can we expect positive momentum, where can we expect negative momentum. As was said earlier today, all eyes are on the US, but we should have eyes on the European Union as well, because the European Parliament is having elections. This impacts on how the European Parliament interacts with the Council. So these two elections are front and center for us. But the kind of important bit from our perspective, from my personal perspective, is that this is not the time to now sit down and read the tea leaves and try to decide who's in the front and who's in the back. Because really, this is the decade when we need to scale. And from our perspective, the direction is set. So the people and companies who wait now, who don't align, who don't think about how they're going to align themselves, they're going to be left behind because the train is moving and the train has left the station. We're seeing, from our perspective, to get on track to net zero, I told you about the 1.8 trillion this year, we need to get that to an average of 4.8 for the rest of the decade. We don't have to hit 4.8 right now, but we need to ramp. So that's almost a tripling, and then further up after that. But this is not only a mandate, it's also a huge investment opportunity. If we think about the energy transition as a project that will take a lifetime, my lifetime, your lifetime, it will take years and it will cost trillions. But it's also an opportunity to invest and be on the right side of history. When we did our new energy outlook last year, we came up with 196 trillion, a fantastical number. But let me just take two observations about this number. The first one is the demand side. So this is everything that has to do with where we use energy is half of the side. So spending on EVs and kind of other forms of demand is a huge side of the energy transition. And the second is that on the supply side, it's good to think about ratios. So the ratio between fossil fuel and low carbon investment on the supply side. And what we're saying is that for every dollar you invest in fossil fuels, we should be investing £5 in clean power. And that is the ratio we're aiming for at the moment. We're at 1:1, roughly, but I'm sure we can do better.